grades and GPA are not everything. I really want to break down the stigma here of asking for help and receiving help because there's nothing wrong with it. So important. This is the one that I really wanted to go over in this video, and that is... everybody, and welcome to or welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, my name is Katie, otherwise known as the Vintage Academic, and I'm a new junior transfer to UC Berkeley. I make informational and fun videos about the transfer process, what it's like as a transfer student, life just as a student in general, and also sometimes some vintage videos just to mix things up a bit. So if that all sounds good to you, don't forget to hit the subscribe button and look for my social media links in the description below. So today I want to talk about some of the things that you can do as a community college student to ensure that you're getting good grades. Now, before we get into the video, I really want to clarify that grades and GPA are not everything. Especially if you're trying to transfer from a community college to the UC system, the UCs really care more that you're a well-rounded individual who can show that you can succeed in school, so even if you start out community college a little rough like I did, they like to see that upward trend in grades. And if you want to know a little bit more about that, click the link in the information card because I do already have a video on my channel about my stats and what I did to get into UC Berkeley, and I think that will be a little bit more informative if that's what you're looking for. Grades are not everything. I don't want you to think that if you're getting bad grades, you're a bad person. That's why I'm making this video. I want to talk about the things that you can do that will help you get good grades, and it's not just study and turn in your assignments on time, because anybody can tell you that. I want to talk about some of the other things that I did to be successful in school, because it's not just about your homework. So this is just a general video of the things that you should be doing in conjunction with your studying to get those good grades. And if you're interested in learning some study skills and what I personally do as a UC student to study, I will make a video on that in the future, so don't forget to subscribe. Okay, let's just move on into the points because I've been talking for too long already. So the first thing that I have to say is to take this seriously. Treat your community college like you're at a four-year university and spending $36,000 a year for your education. Community college is in fact, college. And in order to do well, you really gotta take it seriously and come at it with the right attitude and headspace. This means coming into your lectures ready and willing to listen, committing yourself to the time and energy it's going to take to do school and your homework and your reading, participate in your classes, raise your hand, ask questions, communicate with the professor, and do that even if your classes are online this summer. Really take your education seriously, because you're not going to transfer if you don't think that education is a serious topic. You know, for example, when I went into my first semester of community college, I didn't know what I wanted to do, and because I didn't know what I wanted to do, I kind of didn't really care, and so I ended up getting an F and a C my very first semester. So you really gotta come at it with the right attitude and really take it seriously. Okay, so now that we are in the right headspace, we have the right attitude, we are looking at community college seriously like it's a four-year university, the next thing that I would say is to set aside study slash homework time and study slash homework space. So if you're like me and many other community college students, you might be working your way through community college, and that makes it really important to manage your time. You're gonna need to set aside dedicated time for doing your studying and your homework, because if you don't and the day gets away from you and you don't do it, you're not going to get the points for your homework and you're not gonna do well on your tests. Even if you don't work, blocking out your time to maintain your focus and minimize distractions can really help you understand the material. If you live with roommates or family, make sure that they know when your study time is so that they don't interrupt you while you're focusing. The other really important thing when it comes to the actual act of studying is to have a study space. If you can, I suggest separating your study space from your relaxation space. Now, I know not everybody has this privilege, and we may be sharing bedrooms with somebody, or your bedroom may be really small, but if you can, even do something like doing your homework at the kitchen table, or for example, my desk is out in the living room, or my boyfriend's desk is in the bedroom, but it's still a desk space and not the bed. If you really don't have any space and the only place you can really go to is your bed, then I suggest that you don't get under the covers when you study and buy yourself a little lap desk that you can put either your laptop or your notes on so that you still have this little space that's dedicated to studying. And I'll be right back because somebody's trying to talk to me. Gotta have my laptop with me because people are trying to talk to me. Do I want to be talked to right now? Not really. Okay, we have covered studying time and studying space. Let's move on into getting a planner and getting organized. You must stay organized if you're going to have any hope of doing well in school. I mean, how do you expect yourself to actually remember to turn in your homework assignments if you don't know when they're due? My suggestion for this is to use some sort of planning system in order to know when your homework assignments are due. Something like Google Calendar or a cheap planner from Target or the bullet journal system. Something where you can write down your due dates is essential. Planners help you stay organized by showing you when things are due, and then you can plan out ahead of time how much time it's going to take you to do that, or if you have a test in a week, you can start studying now. When the semester starts, I highly recommend, and I think almost any other academic YouTuber will tell you this, take your syllabi that you get from your professors. Typically, the syllabus will show you all the due dates and the assignments and the papers and the tests that are due with their due date, and so take your syllabi and take whatever planning system that you're planning on using, and take all of those dates and put them in your planner. That way you know exactly when things are due. Basically, the whole point of this one is to write things down in one place so you know where they are, what they are, when they're due, and basically just don't forget to do your homework. Homework is definitely underrated because even if it's a small amount of points, that small amount of points can add up to the point where if you don't do well on your final, you still have those points as backup. Other forms of organization include having a place for all of your papers, like a binder, and having tabs in your binder to organize things by subject, having a notebook for all of your notes, or using an app like GoodNotes or Notability if you have an iPad, in order to keep track of your notebooks and your PDFs. Basically, you need to find a method of organizing that will keep you on track with your due dates, and so that you don't lose all of your papers and your notes. For me, that is a combination of Google Calendar and a physical planner. I also use my iPad with GoodNotes to keep all of my notes and my PDFs and my readings in one spot. Since we are talking about notes, let's move on into the next point, which is finding a note-taking/study system that works for you. If you're new to college, or maybe you just never developed the study skills that you needed when you're in high school, now is the best time to find the note-taking and study technique methods that are best for you. Things like the Pomodoro technique, flashcards, Quizlet, whatever it is that really works best for you, find it and utilize it. Like I said, I want to get more in depth into studying in a later video, but there are also two different types of studying. There is passive studying and active studying. Passive studying is things like reading and taking your notes, revising your notes, and active studying is where you are recalling the information and applying it, so like flashcards and practice problems. And I suggest that you find some sort of balance between the two, doing a little bit of reading and active recall, but like I said, find a studying technique that is best for you. Now, when it comes to notes, there are many different methods that you can use, and even just a simple Google search of note-taking methods will bring up different articles. So there's things like the Cornell method, which you might have learned in high school. I learned it in junior high school. It's not my favorite. There's the mapping method or the outline method. Personally, what I do is I take what I call scratch notes during lecture, where I basically just write down everything the professor says, and then I revise my notes at a later time, where I take them from my physical notebook and I put them in my iPad and I make them look all neat and pretty. And this also doubles for me as a study guide if I do have any tests. Now, I am personally in the social sciences, so I write more papers than I'm taking tests, but if I do ever need to go back and look at my notes, I have them all in one spot. I'm also not sure how well that's going to work for the upcoming semester, so if you have any suggestions, leave them in the comments below, because I will definitely be working on my study skills since I am transitioning from community college to a UC, so it's all new. We're learning together here. Like I said, I'm in the social sciences, and I'm in my upper division classes, which means I don't really take a lot of general education classes anymore. But if you are still in lower division, or you are taking a variety of classes, maybe even utilizing a different note-taking system for each class will be useful for you, because I know that the mapping method might work well for my anthropology class, but I don't think it would work very well for a mathematics class. I also prefer to handwrite my notes, but if you're in a lecture that is really big and you can't raise your hand to ask the professor to slow down, and your professor is like lightning speed lecturer, maybe even typing your notes would be a good solution for you. I don't recommend typing notes because the brain connection to your hand when you're writing things has actually been shown to help you remember things better than typing, but like I said, it depends on your circumstances. So, talking about class, do you like how I'm making all of these segues here? The next thing I would say you should do is prepare before class. This means doing things like the reading that was assigned or any homework problems that were assigned, or even just looking at the syllabus so that you know what you guys are going to go over in class that day. When you're doing your reading or if you're doing practice problems and you have any questions, write them down so that in the lecture, if the professor answers it, you can write down the answer to your question right then and there. Or if the professor doesn't cover it during the lecture, you can raise your hand and ask them or email them or go to office hours. Be prepared for class because it will help you be prepared for the material that you're going to learn in lecture. The next one, and this one is so important, this is the one that I really wanted to go over in this video, and that is seek out the resources that you need. Whether this means disability services or note-taking services, going to the writing center, a technology loan, health services, or even basic needs, whatever it is that you need to be successful in school, seek out the resources that can help you get access to that. So, for example, my community college had a lot of services that ensured equitable access to the things that would help students be successful outside of academics. So they had things like loaner laptops and a no questions asked food bank and physical and mental health services. Basically, what I'm saying is that you can't expect yourself to be successful in school if you don't know how to write papers yet, or even if you don't know where your next meal is going to come from. The stress of not having basic needs met is going to prevent you from being successful, and if you're having mental health issues, that can prevent you from being successful. And so the point of having these services at your school is for students to be able to take advantage of them. I really want to break down the stigma here of asking for help and receiving help, because there's nothing wrong with it. There were periods in my life where I didn't know where my next meal was going to come from either. So it happens to a lot of people and there's nothing wrong with it. But if your school has those resources, definitely take advantage of them if you need them, because they will help you be successful. Okay, that was really serious, but it's a really important topic to talk about, but let's move on into the next one. So the next one is to communicate with your professors and other students. I think that this one is very important and not enough people talk about it. It is really important to maintain communication between yourself and your professors and other students, especially with professors. You can go to their office hours, they're there for a reason, and they're there to help you if you have any questions or you're not sure what to do for an assignment. Even if something happens and you need more time for an assignment, professors are, in my experience, pretty willing to work with you. You just have to reach out to them. In addition, developing relationships with professors can encourage you to do better in their classes, and sometimes it can even lead to opportunities outside of the classroom, like letters of recommendation or internship or externships or research positions, things like that. And then I also think it's really important to develop relationships with other students. I always had at least one person in each class who I could go to if I missed a class and I needed help with notes or an assignment. Especially when it comes to English classes, I always had a fellow student look over my English papers for me. In fact, I actually think it was because I did this that I got an A in my English class, so thank you to that person who helped me with my papers. Alright, the next one, second to last one, is kind of my secret weapon, extra credit. Now in the upper division classes, once you've transferred to a four-year, I'm not sure how common extra credit is, but in the lower division classes at your community college, at least in my experience, extra credit was pretty common. I always took advantage of extra credit opportunities to either fix a bad grade, make up for a test that I did poorly on, or even to get enough points that I could skip out on homework or a test if I had to. It was kind of like my backup or my buffer between a good grade and a bad grade. For example, in my biological anthropology class, I did so much extra credit that the professor called me in to talk to me and she said that I had so many points that I could not take the final and still get an A in the class. So basically, extra credit can be the difference between a passing and a failing grade, and I mean, it can be a backup if you got sick and missed a paper or something like that. Basically, it's just good to have extra points when you can get them. My last thing that I want to share with you guys is that you have to care. Care about your education and care enough about yourself to do well in school. This means doing all of the above, finding a study technique that works for you, taking advantage of resources, communicating with your professors, all of those things. You have to care about yourself enough to do them. If you want to get those good grades in your community college to set yourself up for a good transfer, then you probably already care, but the point is, care about your education and care about yourself. And caring about yourself also includes making sure that you're taking care of yourself, your mental health, and your physical physical health, make sure you're getting enough sleep, eating well, drinking water, talking things out with people if you need to. So that was all that I have for you guys today. I can see my battery is flashing at me and it's telling me that it's gonna die, so I'm going to wrap it up here. If you liked this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel for more videos like this, and don't forget to leave me a comment below if you have any questions, comments, or concerns. I am happy to answer anything. And look in my description box for more links to things, including my social media, and also there is a Google form in there that you can fill out to schedule a one-on-one college admissions consultation with me to go over your UC personal insight questions if that is a service that you are looking for. Thank you all so much for watching. I really appreciate you being here and spending time with me, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!